0424-223-7663 for a quote today, or visit our website www.lifetimesolutionstt.com.
Good morning again and welcome. I hope you enjoyed that discussion with Dr. Roger Hussein on the macro condition globally, regionally, and the challenges in Trinidad and Tobago and how we could get out. And we have now Mr. Derek Chin on the line. And we want to have a discussion with him about business in Trinidad and Tobago. He's an entrepreneur, he's a businessman. He started very small. Today you might call him a pretty big businessman in terms of the range of businesses that he is involved in, not only in Trinidad and Tobago, but in Guyana and elsewhere. But he started pretty small, you know. He made himself from nothing, and he tried very hard. He was very entrepreneurial in spirit. And all these things that exist today that he has created, he created, you might say, out of nothing over time. And I have nothing but respect for people like that who are willing to take the risk and who are able to make something out of nothing. So, Derek, I want to thank you for agreeing to be on the program. And I want to say good morning to you and welcome.
Well, thank you very much, Bo, and it's a pleasure for me to be here. Thank you for the invitation.
Yes. Well, tell me, what is the state of your business now, given the number of shutdowns that we've had in Trinidad and Tobago due to the COVID pandemic? How has that affected you? I know, for instance, that you have a major restaurant establishment, you can say the name, and that you also have Movie Town, which is in many locations in Trinidad and Tobago. So can you begin by talking about that, and you may talk about other things as well.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Like everybody else, and many of those who are in business in Trinidad and Tobago, you know, we are in a state of dire straits, to put it in mildly. You know, we are obviously having some serious situations dealing with the pandemic and the shutdowns. And not only has it been a short period of time, but for a very long period of time. We unfortunately are in the hospitality and entertainment industry, and you know, COVID is anti-entertainment, anti-hospitality, anti-socialization. So as a result of that, you know, we are the ones who have probably felt the brunt from day one. You know, the first time there's any talk about a closure, it is the entertainment and social area that tends to get closed down quickly first. And then, of course, the lack of time, because if they are to open, we are usually the last businesses to be given that go-ahead green light. So in terms of, you know, our ability to stay around, we have obviously made a business that has some debt. Unfortunately, there's so much we can go. The situation is coming now into, I would say, very serious. We have obviously many, many employees. We employ almost 2,400 people in the chain of our restaurants, our movie theaters, and so on, and many other businesses that we have associated. So it's a very difficult time for us, and we are looking for hopefully a solution soon, and that it's not going to be a phased opening, that at least we can see some sort of positiveness from the government to start to reflect and understand what we are all enduring. And I'm sure that they know that they need to start opening up soon, because it's almost, in the case of the movie theaters, months, you know, in some cases a year. And in terms of the restaurants, we've had, I would say, 12 months to 15 months of partial openings, limited capacity, no quick packaged food, no alcohol, no takeaway service. So if it is that you want to have all the elements of closing down a business, well, the hospitality restaurant business is exactly experiencing that. So this is in a very bad situation. I know many other businesses are, if not the same or in worst case scenario. We have 9 restaurants in Trinidad and a few in Guyana and elsewhere. Some places around have opened up, so we've been able to try and keep those away internationally floating. But it is in a bad way, and especially in the cinema industry, which really needs to get some sort of green light quickly. You know, we've obviously part of the entertainment, we've considered non-essential, but I don't like the idea of saying that all these businesses are not essential businesses, because remember, they employ a lot of people, and therefore, if they don't have a job and they don't have any sort of salary or wages, then they become desperate, and they're unable to pay their bills and get food for their families. So in fact, it's essential for them. So in my estimation, you know, all businesses, everything that we are about is essential.
What is happening to your employees? How are they living?
Well, you know, we started off figuring, well, this thing may not be longer than 2 to 3 months, and we figured that, okay, we searched the laws and said that some can be extended and kept going, especially in the areas of maintenance, the security, the projection, that's where we have to keep the projectors and the cinema technology parts working, even though we are closed. And they've been furloughed. A majority now are furloughed because we just couldn't keep them on the payroll for that length of time, not many. We've tried to do things like, you know, support them with some loans and some hampers and so on, but because of the length of time, you know, it has become very difficult. Most of my meetings every day are with the financiers, you know, trying to figure out how best we can get that kind of extension, that hold on interest, which accrues all the time. We have had success, but every time we make a decision and we sign off something, you know, the lockdown gets extended and everything starts to go back to zero. We have to start all over again.
Yeah.
So,
and that is costly.
We find it very frustrating, you know. Every time we spend hours and hours negotiating, because the banks obviously are under pressure too, you know. But it is, I'm hoping that this time, you know, openings will happen. We'll be told that, okay, the next installment will be September, October. But I said, you know, what happens if this thing continues into August? We have no ways of putting revenue to even meet those commitments. And therefore, we have to reassess again. One of the good parts, I suppose, is that Movie Town has been fairly established. It's a good business model. We have tremendous assets where we are in Spain. We don't have a lot of loans, thank God. But at the end of the day, you know, we have to make these commitments, and it's an ongoing process.
But how have the banks been with you, and what has been the impact on your other stakeholders in the system? Because every business is really part of an ecosystem that is mutually supportive.
Oh, yeah, because, you know, when you talk about a restaurant business or a movie town, you know, we have many, many suppliers, you know, and some of them are not a very large, and they're, you know, we try to help out a lot of the smaller business people. You know, for example, you know, we sell planting chips and bread chips now, and a lot of them are from small, you know, small businesses and wontons, you know, which are made by local restaurants, Chinese restaurants. So they depended on that. We do buy a lot, but now that has been cut off. So all the supplier chains are affected. And they themselves have to obviously buy the raw materials from other people. So it's a tremendous impact, not only in terms of all business, but all the way down the food chain.
And that's
what affects the whole country, because it's one business has been sort of terminated or ended or not working. It affects many other businesses. And in terms of the banks have been working with us. I think we've had very good relationships with all of them. We've always made our commitments and paid off many of our liabilities. But again, at the end of the day, you know, they have to ensure that, one, that we are still around. So they have to ensure that they go that extra mile to ensure that we can make it. We have been able to, as of today, successfully negotiated with three of the major institutions that we borrow from. But again, it worries us to know, you know, we want to get open, we want to meet these commitments, we want to hire back our staff. We have, you know, personally, I get calls from many of my staff asking if I can help them. And I told them we'll try our best, but, you know, there's just so much we can do. We just don't have those resources. And at the end of the day, you know, the governments haven't come forward and said, listen, we understand your position. We are prepared to offer you a grant, or maybe future back payments can be deferred or cut in half or whatever. Give us some assurance, you know, that all is not lost and they're going to help us out along the way, because we do require a substantial number of people who, as I said, it's not a lie, they are suffering. They are, you know, in dire straits. And I try to reach out to them sometimes, you know, I would call and ask them how they're doing. These are more my administrative staff. In my offices right now, there's just a skeleton staff. Yes. We don't know whether we can start to bring people back in to start developing our marketing plans or to review some of our promos that we want to do when we get open, you know, and that is also very challenging.
Yeah. The what about your knowledge, your intimate personal knowledge of other businesses that might not be your stakeholders, but these people are colleagues of yours or collaborators of yours, or you might talk to them as business people to find out how they are doing in their sector. What is your sense of what's happening in terms of their assessment of what's going on in the economy and society?
Well, as you know, we are also landlords, so we have a lot of tenants. So that would give me a good feel as to what is happening out there. Right now, we have charged tenants no rent for the last 2 months and going in out of July, August. So we have no income from that. We do charge them a small portion on what you call the CAM or the common services. That's the security, the common lighting, and that sort of thing. But all of them are in dire straits. You know, many of them, I mean, if you know, if you charge any sort of, like, even at 20% of rent, they would fold. They're thankful for the fact that we are not, you know, going out and charging, because I understand, I have compassion to know that just like us, if you have no income, how can you pay rent, how can you pay wages, and so on and so forth. So to answer your question, the majority, if not majority, and we have a large spectrum here in terms of retail, you know, clothing, hardwares, food, and so on, that are obviously very difficult to really get commitment. Some of them were owing before because of the length of time, and they are stuck making those agreed payments, you know, or scheduled payment in light of the situation. So in terms of businesses that are closing, we've lost quite a few here already. All mall is down, probably another 30% of tenants that have decided to leave. We tried our best to try and stretch it out and make for them to stay. But I'm sure this is reflected, like you've seen it in Trin City Mall, you've seen it in West Mall, you've seen it in Long Sigma Mall, where all these businesses are empty space, a lot of places for rent. And you just have to drive around the communities and the neighborhoods and see. Never have I seen so many for rent and for sales signs going up. So it gives you a very clear reflection on what is really happening out there.
Okay. What is happening to the real estate market because of that?
Well, it's obviously difficult, you know. It's difficult to get a rent. People have, I mean, it's probably good for a renter because you would get probably a great deal. There are many spaces. We have another properties too that we're trying to rent, and we have no real bites. No, we are negotiating a few that may happen in the near future. But overall, as I said, you know, you look around, you see all these for rental signs and empty spaces and buildings for sale. And you realize that, it's right through the spectrum, you know, because obviously people have lost confidence in the country. They see the economy. Who would be in their right mind want to invest? Me, myself. I have a number of projects which pre-COVID I was planning to do. I've already committed. All the goods are here. All the equipment is here. And I'm in 2 months whether I want to really do anything again or ready to transfer everything to maybe another country. and try there, because there's nothing happening. One of the things I wanted to mention in the interview is that if it's an advice to the government, is they need to provide degrees of hope and substantial hope. Not everything is negative. Everything is foreclosure and negativity. I call Trinidad the land of the bees, you know, not bees, buzz, but the land of bees, meaning everything is a block, a boycott, you know, a blockade, a bacchanal, you know, and I think we need to change that so that it's a land of peace, of positiveness. Give people hope that, you know, okay, this is tough for everybody, but reach out there and start having this bickering between opposition and government. And they talked at the start of coming together. Let us, we are all in this together. But, you know, when you reflect in the last 12 months, where is the togetherness? Where is the unity? Where is the leadership, you know, to take us forward? And I can't see us repairing what has happened and all the difficulties and the differences in how things have happened to put us on a confident footing for the future. So people like ourselves who have, you know, billions of dollars in assets now, you know, I have to worry about, you know, what we really can make it work, you know? I mean, we can't pick up and leave, but at the end of the day, you know, we really need to look at making our investments somewhere else, which hurts the country.
Yeah. I will come back to this issue of confidence, but I want to ask you a question having to do with the management of the pandemic. Initially, I think the Prime Minister and the government generally would have taken the position that we have a choice between lives and livelihoods, and we are going to choose life. But do you think that in their understanding of the connection between lives with livelihoods, that they somehow misunderstood, miscalculated, did not understand the synergies and the sequence, and therefore kind of exacerbated the problem in Trinidad and Tobago?
Well, it's obviously a very challenging situation or scenario they found themselves in. The pandemic is obviously unprecedented, not only in Trinidad, but throughout the world.
All over
the world. But yes, I think I have to agree with you from some degree, because I experienced it, because I was stranded, as you know, last year in Miami due to my medical issues from March right into the end of June, 3 months of being by myself. And a lot of the issues which you talk about in linking lives and livelihoods, also they fail to understand the mental lesion that it affects people's psyche. And a lot of it, nobody's reporting that. I think there's every so often there's a talk about the psychiatric problems, depression, and suicide, young and old people now, and a lot of that ends up in people dying or not having a good life. So it has been very difficult, very challenging, but I felt that there was a need for a concerted plan to take into consideration that livelihoods are also important. That, yes, lives are, you know, life is risk. You have to take some measured risks. It's like I came up a nice saying the other day where, you know, it's like, you're driving a car, your chances are you could get killed or injured in a car accident. But does that mean everybody has to stop driving? And that's where the problem is. I think we have to try and ensure that there's some balance, there's some feel to let people still live life. I mean, I and many others around the world and yourself have lost 2 years of life, never to be replaced again, or be locked down and having to be taking medications to spend happy and to keep stabilized, you know? So there is a part that needs to be looked at more carefully. That's why I talked about hope and doing things to let people start to live a little bit, you know? We have to realize that COVID is here. Unfortunately, it's here for maybe another couple of years. Thank God that maybe there's some positivity in the vaccination programs. We are behind the eight ball there. We need to get that up and going quicker. But, you know, there are people who are suffering because they don't have a job, they don't have income, they don't know how to pay their rent, they have to buy food and so on and so on. There's domestic violence because of that and so on and so forth. So I think that a lot of that particular link and that relationship has not been addressed properly. And it has only been concentrating on things that, as I just said, I don't want to criticize, but, you know, when you review things out, it should be working. And therefore, we need to look at it again and see what needs to be done to balance both the lives and the livelihoods.
And livelihoods. Yes. We just have about a minute, and I'm going to close on the issue that you raised of confidence, because it's very important. You're saying that as an entrepreneur, as an investor, you had plans and you are hesitant about executing those plans in Trinidad and Tobago now. And you said that confidence has waned. You said that you might have to rethink, maybe you can invest somewhere else. What is happening to confidence in Trinidad and Tobago? And it could not be just the management of the COVID pandemic by the government. It has to be more. What is happening to the confidence level of the business community in the country?
Okay, well, certainly confidence from handling the COVID has made a lot of people, and I think that's one of the big problems that the government doesn't realize, is they lost confidence in some of the decision-making processes in how it's been handled. But I don't want to go there. Not enough yes. has been said about that. But what it does to the business community is that, even before COVID, the economy was in a tailspin. And there's nothing new that has happened other than more negative things to give people any sense of hope. Those who have major investments or are planning to make investments, it seems to be only in a specific area. And I think that the loss of confidence is going to be a seriously affect this country, especially with so many places closing, no turnaround in immediate effect or immediate term. People can only go so far. They spent a whole lifetime trying to build a legacy, build your businesses, try to employ people, do your part to help to make the country better. And then you're faced with things that are happening beyond your control that says, I spent 24, 30 years of trying my best to build something worthwhile, and now it's all going to be left in tatters. And there's no support on that. There's no appreciation that you're hiring people, that you're helping your fellow countrymen. A lot of people know me for the many things I do behind the scenes. And it's very, very, upsetting. So I think that confidence in the economy was on the way before COVID. It has gotten worse. Many people who may have wanted to do things, in terms of expanding their businesses. We've been thinking about that. I've invested in a whole new building to do some projects that will again, be worthwhile to the country. But I am saying, boy, I don't know what the future holds. Let me hold back. And I'm sure this is multiplied throughout the country with people who want to make investments, who want to make contributions. And you're not seeing that happening in the private sector at all. And that's a very important element to turn this country around, that you need foreign investment, you need private investment, you need confidence. And that's definitely out the window right now.
All right. Derek, we have to leave at this point. I want to thank you for coming on the program and for engaging the issues that you did, I think, very straightforward and honestly. I want to invite you on another occasion. I hope that you will agree to come. We will continue the discussion a little bit because this is an important conversation. And I want to thank you for basically being a guest on the program. And I want to wish you luck. I hope we will have a reopening soon, and your businesses will be able to get back on their feet. So take care.
Okay, well, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I know everybody wants to get the movies. They need to see some movies now, So I hope it happens. Thank you so much.
I'd like to go and see a movie too.
Yeah. Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay. This is where we break for a minute.
Welcome to Lifetime Solutions, where you can trust your roof to us. Our services include custom fabrication, steel framing, roofing installation, on-site roll forming, roofing maintenance and services. Call 223-ROOF or 223-7663 for a quote today or visit our website. www.lifetimesolutionstt.com. Lifetime Solutions. You can trust your roof to us. Call 223-ROOF or 223-7663 for a quote today or visit our website www.lifetimesolutionstt.com.
I am your host, D-R-A-M-A, accent to the last A, Drama.
Yeah, your last words
my
to
last
Rebel.
My last words, and I can remember.
Your last recalled words to Rebel.
Like today.
You want to go to space?
Well, I'm in space already, you
know. It never outdated future legend. Emerged from the scene in 2007. Always sat up and rhythm, yeah, with Polly Baden.